chapter. But basically, we're talking about how did computer systems as a whole come into play, okay? I don't know if you use computer systems in the 80s or the 70s, but if you look at those systems, there was no sort of, how can I say this? There was no start menu, there was no flashy stuff, there was no sort of emoji icons, nothing, isn't it? Literally, you had to type everything. So we're using a DOS-based system, disk-based operating system. And the problem with that system is, you're smiling, so I'm guessing you had a lot of problems with that. If you entered something incorrectly, what happened? That's it, bang, everything's gone, isn't it? And you had remember Stiffy drives? Floppy disks?
Yes, I remember that.
How was the storage capacity?
And
Mark
was fish.
That's not good. Okay, but this is the point, okay? IT has sort of really evolved in the 70s to what we have now. And what you sort of need to talk about is on the next page, page 38. In terms of evolution and acceleration, in the 60s, there was this guy called Moore. And what Moore basically predicted was that every 2 years, IT systems would evolve to the point where if you bought a computer now, 2 years' time, this computer is outdated. So today, guess what that's happening in? 6 months.
Wow.
Within 6 months, you buy a computer today, in 6 months' time, that computer is literally outdated. And the reason for this is obviously competition, that's one. But the second real driver of this is basically the pace at which IT is sort of self-fulfilling, okay? It's exponential. Where if you had a, for example, a 1000 megahertz computer back in around 1998, by the time you reach 2000, you'll be hitting 2000 megahertz, etc. Today we've gone into quad-core, 6-core, 8-core processing, and it's just going further and further. I mean, the cell phones that you carry with you today would beat a 1998 laptop. There's no way a 98 laptop could process what your cell phone does today.
Yeah.
And you carry this in your pocket, okay? So that's evolution and acceleration there. But what really sort of set this off was 3.1.3, the microcomputer revolution, the basic, the PCs that you use every day at work, etc. And this was basically your typewriter-sized computers, okay? So this part is not that important. What is important is 3.2.1, your mainframe and supercomputers. This is examinable. First, let's talk about the mainframe. Your mainframe computer is basically your server computer. I'm just going to give an example. I don't know too much about the retail environment, I was very short in that. But I'll give an example of a bank. So all of us go to the bank at some point in time, isn't it? And we generally hate going to the bank because queues, etc., etc. And also, salary comes in and the next day the debit orders go out. So that's one issue. But here's the key thing. We use an ATM, isn't it? But is an ATM really an expensive machine? An ATM, from an IT point of view, we refer to it as a dumb machine. It literally has nothing on it. So if you netbank, for example, you could put maybe 20,000 KZN ATMs that are really, really cheap, okay? Doesn't really do anything, so what happens? You go there with your bank card, isn't it? You put your bank card in, and then it reads information from your card, and then it says, okay, put in PIN number. Once you put in PIN number, what do you ever really think about what you do once you put your PIN number? Yes, you're accessing your profile, but where are you accessing your profile from? Literally, you, when you go to the ATM, you are accessing your bank's mainframe computer. That's what you're doing. So the ability of a mainframe computer is to, and pay attention to this, handle routine daily transactions. That's what it does. It handles routine daily transactions, a large volume of transactions, and the third most important thing that a mainframe computer does is this thing of time sharing. So 50 people could be using 50 ATMs running off the same mainframe computer, and this computer would share its tasks, its abilities between these 50 people simultaneously. Okay? So this is what time sharing does. And obviously, from a business point of view, it makes sense to have one mainframe computer rather than 50 really sort of expensive computers. Okay? So I basically covered the bottom of page 38 there. Now, on the other hand, page 39 talks about a supercomputer. Supercomputer is a bit different. So a supercomputer, I wish I could show you a picture of this, but supercomputers basically look like filing cabinets. And they usually start up at below minus 38 degrees. So why are supercomputers so important? Well, NASA uses a supercomputer, Deep Blue. It's called IBM Deep Blue 2. And what this supercomputer does is literally only one thing. The one thing that it does is connected to the Hubble telescope, and it's literally counting stars and planets out there. So billions, it's counting billions of galaxies and stars and whatever per second. And it does this 24 hours, 7 days a week. Doesn't ever shut down. So supercomputers are used for advanced things, usually advanced scientific things. Things like designing a plane, things like sort of simulating complex environments. Actuarial science, economists actually use supercomputers sometimes when you have to do, you know, forecasting, etc. It's very hard to predict human behavior. Okay? So the difference between a mainframe and a supercomputer is that a mainframe does many things. Okay, does many things. It's mainly used by banks, etc. And a supercomputer does one thing, but the one thing that it does it really well. Okay? So it could be calculations, it could be graphics, etc., etc. I'm not going to go into workstations and PCs. It's designed for special purpose, yeah. I'm not going to go into workstations and PCs too much, but basically workstations are used by scientists, engineers, etc. Workstation is slightly, it used to be slightly more powerful than your personal computer, your PC. Why I'm not so interested in it is that today's computers, personal computers, are equivalent to workstations. So you as a firm, when you go out there to buy IT equipment, you just buy a personal computer, isn't it? You don't really think about what you're buying there. Portable computers, everybody uses the laptop, so you know what a laptop is. I'm not going to go over that. What we do need to talk about briefly is on page 40, the emergence of networks. Okay? Computer systems always existed. They existed since World War II. But when we go into sort of networking, where somebody sort of thought about what happens if I take computer A and computer B and put them up together. So literally we're talking about the birth of the internet. And what networking does from the organization's point of view, we'll talk about this more in chapter 4 under hardware, but think about this. Networking, a couple of things, beyond just communicating, etc., it's really cost efficient, isn't it? From a firm's point of view, if you have 100 staff with 100 computers, does it mean you need to buy 100 printers? No, you buy one printer, you have one software package, and you run it off the network, isn't it? So we'll talk about this in greater detail later on. Things like internet explosion and internet culture, we're not going to be interested in. And same with living with computers. But page 43 is a bit important. Implication of, and what are the social and ethical issues associated with computer systems? There's a couple of things, okay? I'm sure everybody here either has some form of social media, either using WhatsApp, Facebook, Instagram, or some sort of system, okay? Now this is a bit problematic in the sense that IT systems emerge really, really quickly. Social media emerged really, really quickly. If you follow what happened with Trump and the Twitter, and then they started accusing the Russians of hacking the American elections, and it goes on and etc. You can see the impact that social media has on our everyday life. This is something we take for granted, okay? So the first issue is personal privacy. You don't know this, but as soon as you subscribe, as soon as you use an Android cell phone, you sign away your privacy. Google starts keeping track of every single thing that you do, okay? Whether you're going to incognito mode, private mode, whatever mode, Google knows. As long as you Google it, they know. And what do they do with this information? Well, 3 to 4 years ago, they used to take this information, compile it, just like how an insurance company would compile information, and sell it to whoever's, you know, interested in it. So data mining of your browsing habits, okay? And the issue with this, there was a guy in the European Union, so basically from Spain, who took Google, the EU division, to court. It took him 4 years to get his name removed from Google search engine. But he was a billionaire, so he could afford that kind of lawsuit. So this is the thing, where is your privacy? Okay, that's the first part. The second thing is, IT crime and the difficulty of keeping data secure. You know this from an organizational point of view. Hackers today are becoming sort of this group anonymous. And what they do is, they hijack a firm's sort of IT system and say, look, you pay us maybe $2 million or $3 million dollars in Bitcoin, okay? I'm gonna give you back your system. So that's the other problem. And this is becoming
Bitcoin. Bitcoin.
Bitcoin.
It's an online currency, but I'm thinking,
it's an online currency, but because it's completely unregulated, all your unsavory stuff, your basically your drug dealers, etc., are now switching to that.
Bitcoin,
So they're talking about regulation.